Check it out now, y'all.
nanoHUB-U, online instruction.
Hi, I'm Edwin Garcia. This is lecture 3 of the third week of the material science of rechargeable batteries. And today I'm going to talk about inhomogeneities and correlations in tortuosity in battery materials. Last lecture, we were talking about how, depending on where you are in a rechargeable battery electrode, you can have a very tightly packed set of particles, or you can have a lot of spaces and some clusters of particles in the system. And as a result of that, given that you will have a distribution of particles in your electrode, you will find that the particle size distribution is really segregated so that the smaller particles are on the edge and the larger particles, the bulk, is in the center, suggesting with that that really the properties that the average properties that we're measuring are really position dependent, and what we're getting is just a shift of those properties with respect to what the bulk value would be. Okay, this analysis were made in using particles that are as very close to a perfectly spherical distribution of particles. So this, of course, will not happen in a much more commercial or industrial type setting. What we're going to be talking about today is how deviations from this carefully set up device impact directly on what properties the material will have. Okay. And for that, here is a microstructure that was reported by Shearing, Howard, Jorgensen, Brandon, and Harris. And this particular case, this one is a graphite anode. It almost looked like a piece of steak or a hamburger. But you can see here that it has all these porous paths that go from one side of the other one. The porosity is very low. You can see it's 0.154, which makes it a high energy density anode. Interestingly enough, you can see that 95% of those pores are connected, meaning that there's 5% porosity that is isolated. You could find basically pores that don't go anywhere. They don't connect to any location in the electrode. As I was saying, the thickness in this case becomes very small as compared to what you see in other devices, because the idea is to pack as much energy as possible. People did is they look at the porosity and tortuosity of the entire section, and then they started to split it into individual cross sections. But you can see here sections of roughly 85 or 80 by 80 as they go along, and look locally as to how the porosity and tortuosity varied in that system. Okay, and just to give you an idea on why this becomes important. If you take a section out of that particular electrode, you will find that, well, this 49 by 60 by 60, which would be a section somewhere about here, okay, will have a porosity which could be much larger, which would be on the order of roughly 29.5%. And the properties that this one will give, if we believe on the Bruchman relationship, this material will have a lower tortuosity as compared to the entire structure, which really doesn't make any sense. So what we did is, we just started looking at individual sections and the different sections, really because of the inhomogeneities, will deliver a different response. And here you can see how the porosity is distributed across each of the individual samples. And you can see how in some regions, actually, the porosity becomes, it's below the threshold, below 20%. It varies from some place to the other one. But in some places where even you have porosities that are equivalent, the tortuosities can vary widely. For example, here you have roughly 15% porosity, and you have a tortuosity that it's above 10. And for a similar spot here, you can see a tortuosity is of the order of six. So what this calculation based on measurement tells you is that it not only matters the porosity that you put, but the local microstructure on how those particles in this particular case, those, that very complex topology is organized to give you the tortuosity that you will measure out of the system. So, because the relationship between tortuosity and porosity is not given anymore by the Brugmann relationship, then Harris and co-workers decided to look at those correlations. And here you have, for each of the individual sections, the log of the tortuosity is a function of the log of the porosity. And by using all the individual sections, they devise a new relationship. For two anode samples that they had, leading to that, to very different Brugmann exponents. Remember, the Brugmann exponent before was 1/2. And in this case, the Brugmann exponent, depending on what subsample you're looking at, it will vary from 1.8 to 2.3. And in some cases, it will dip all the way down to 1.7. So clearly, that relationship that was originally developed for a perfectly spherical, close to monodispersed particles, it stops working, suggesting really that the losses that we're getting in a real battery are not only a result of the volume fraction, but the morphology itself and how that morphology actually impacts on the result on the system. Okay, so because of that, this relationship shows us that the material really doesn't respond as much as we want. And in fact, the relationship tau equals 1 over epsilon to the 1/2, we really should recast it to something more that looks like this. Well, really, tau should really be some coefficient, pre-coefficient b over epsilon to the alpha. Right? What alpha would be the new Brugmann exponent, and b would be the new Brugmann coefficient. Okay, and from that perspective, this relationship would be much more general, and as you can see, and at least these results suggest that there's something in addition to the volume fraction that we have to take into account, and we would need to really resolve that. Maybe it is the particle interactions, not necessarily the shape of the particles. Maybe it's just those interactions. So, well, the first thing that we need to do in order to quantify that is we need to quantify how those particles are organized. In some cases, you can have that the particles, because they have different sizes, maybe they are they define amorphous regions, or maybe what we want, or what is actually controlling the tortuosity, is the ordering of the system. So for that, we need to define a quantity that specifies the ordering of the system, so that in the slide that you will see next, if the material is very close to have perfect ordering, basically the particles define some crystal lattice type of particle distribution, this parameter psi will have a value of 1, and it differs from that ordering. Say, for example, if it's amorphous, it'll have a value different from 1. If it's amorphous but it has very few nearest neighbors, it will have a value smaller than 1, and if it has, each particle has a lot of nearest neighbors greater than 12, then this number will be greater than 1. Okay. Now, for a typical battery, if we go back to that battery that had perfectly spherical particles, we can quantify the individual local ordering of the system. In this case, you can see the entire electrode, and you can see how particles, big particles, look, in this case, are highlighted as red as a result of having a lot of nearest neighbors. You can see, for example, that here this big red particle surrounded with a lot of tiny little particles that are basically attached to it as a result of that. While at the very surface, you can see you have these blue particles suggesting that they have very few neighbors surrounding them, giving you, as you can see, a very detailed description on how the particles are distributed. And well, if instead we start thresholding it and basically just visualize those particles, that have few nearest neighbors that are very, regions that are very porous, you can see that there may be some percolated regions, some regions where these particles basically connect and make chains between each other. But most of them are localized on the surfaces, but there's really no ordering and there's no, doesn't seem to appear any correlation there. Those that would be, that actually comply with our measure of perfect ordering, you can see we really, they really don't seem to lead to the description of actual clusters of ordered particles. While those that would have a lot of nearest neighbors, that's what you can see much more in the core. And in the core of that electrode, you can see, all those particles have a lot of nearest neighbors, suggesting that really the big particles are glued together by small particles, and defining with that the actual response of the system. So, from this description, what comes to mind is that it is really that polydispersity that is disturbing the possibility of having a low tortuosity electrode. So, if instead we decide to look at particles that are close to monodispersity, maybe that way we will be able to find an electrode structure that has, that is organized. And if you think about it, right, if you have your particles that actually manage to be perfectly aligned, you could define these in the interstices between the particles, these pathways between them that will give you the possibility of having a low tortuosity system. So, if you see that on the next slide, here you have for the case of particles that are perfectly monodispersed, and how they it actually looks just at the naked eye, you can see that particles seem to have developed a perfectly organized structure. But as you increase the degree of polydispersity, you can see that the ordering is destroyed. In fact, this calculation demonstrates that this walls of the domain that we're using to simulate the system are become locations where the order structures would nucleate and propagate to the center. Okay, while as we cross the barrier of 0.4 times the particle size of polydispersity, that ordering is completely destroyed. So by the time we have a polydispersity of one particle size in width, there will be no ordering left anymore. Okay, so, well, that really leaves us that the only way to make order structures, whose, by the way, it's tortuosity we haven't determined yet, corresponds to having electrodes that are perfectly ordered, perfectly organized. And, well, as a result of that, well, we can actually look at electrodes that are actually perfectly ordered. This can be done using processing methods such as colloidal processing. And, well, you can always make the particles interact with each other in such a way that they find the minimum energy configuration in an analogy to atomic systems, so that those atoms, when they reorganize, their only minimum energy configuration is one that develops a periodic structure. So an FCC structure, you can see, is one of the possibilities. You have HCP, BCC, and not knowing if it's even possible to assemble. Well, in a computer, it's easy to establish an hexagonal crystal structure. So if you compare all of those against the Bruggemann relationship, you can see that FCC actually delivers a tortuosity that is indeed lower than the Bruggemann ideal. In fact, the one that delivers the lowest tortuosity corresponds to BCC. You can see here there's a difference between 1.85 to 1.5 in tortuosity. Okay, roughly half a point of tortuosity drop. And as a point of reference, you can see the real microstructures are still consistently above the line because of the clustering that we were discussing on the previous lecture. And here the pink dots correspond to each of them to 10 simulations for constant porosity. And you can see that little bar over there corresponds to the actual error bar, how the tortuosity, as you simulate 10 of these microstructures, the polydispersity stretches, or the dispersity of the measurement stretches as it becomes tighter and tighter. It's really hard to go beyond this number As you can see, why? Because these structures, FCC and BCC, especially FCC, is the most tightly packed structure, so it's really hard to go beyond that point. So, well, again, this structure, FCC, will become very expensive to fabricate, okay? And as a result of that, well, maybe we can get away with a little bit of disorder. We know that we can go all the way to 40% polydispersity. So how much should we do that? So in this case, Tony Chung performed some calculations where he analyzed the effect of that tortuosity and its of that tortuosity and its reactivity for perfectly monodispersed structures, and created a computer-generated microstructure of the 40% polydispersity just to show at what point to see if it indeed actually breaks that tortuosity is broken. Okay, but more important, we not only care about the tortuosity of the system, we care about the reactivity of the system. And you can think of that this very tightly packed structure, because we can put more particles per unit volume, that also means that we can put more area per unit volume, giving us a relative instantaneous power that is greater than this other structure, where even though we may have the same porosity, the amount of area per unit volume may be lower. So, as a result of that, okay, you can see here the amount of area density as a function of porosity, and you can see that the ideal corresponds to this line over here. Okay, this would be to a perfectly monodispersed structure given by that one. Okay, and when we reach the polydispersity of one particle size, well, we drop down basically by a factor of 3 with respect to the previous value, while the experimental structures are here somewhere in the middle. Right? Suggesting really that we are close to that response, okay, but we are still at least a factor of 2 off to what a real microstructure can give us. Now, this corresponds to this data set. If instead we compare it against the one where we have different types of different amounts of compaction, then what we will get is really that that we are much closer to what the lowest power density of this battery can deliver, just from the geometrical perspective. And clearly, down here we would have the highest tortuosity possible, okay, and down here the lowest one. But what you really want is to tune your tortuosity and your particle size polydispersity to maximize your reactivity. So these blue diamonds corresponds to a polydispersity of 10%, suggesting here that you have a very small deviation, also in the order of 10%. So that means that you really don't need to go all the way to have perfectly monodispersed particles, but if you have a deviation of 10%, you can still recover and deliver a response that it's equivalent to the one that a perfectly ordered structure will give you. You would also save some money in that sense, because you wouldn't have to actually reach the crystal limit, and then of course you can, in theory at least, be able to reach the performance that you want. Okay. So now in the next lecture, what we're going to do, since until this point we have basically focused on the effect of size and volume fraction and all these inhomogeneities, we will focus on the next lecture on the effect of anisotropy of the system. Okay? So looking forward to chatting with you. Thank you.